Good afternoon and welcome here today. And I'm Paolo Pozzilli, and I'm professor of endocrinology and diabetes here at Barts and in London, and also in Rome at University Campus Biomedico. I've been living between London and Rome for the past 30 years. And actually, some of you probably are familiar with Barts Hospital. Barts Hospital and Rome are closely linked. Starting in 1123, where Raher, the founder of Barts Hospital, a monk, was admitted to the Tiberina Island in Roma, opposite the synagogue, and there is a hospital there, still there, and it's called Fate Bene Fratelli Hospital, and that hospital has a church in front of it that is called San Bartholomew's Basilica now. And Raher was sick, probably suffered from malaria, and he was admitted to the hospital and then went to pray into the Basilica of San Bartolomeo. And then he survived his illness and back to London. He founded the Hospital for the Poor of London. They call it San Bartholomew's. So that's the reason why San Bartolomeo, as we say in Italian, has been the mother and father of all teaching hospital in London. So today I'm going to discuss with you the issue of diabetes. As you see from the title, Diabetes, the New Epidemic. I'm going to present some of the data so you become familiar with the number of patients all over the world affected by diabetes. Now, these are the number of people with diabetes, including age 20 to 80, according to the International Diabetes Federation Atlas that was published last year. And what it really appears that there are countries, this is in brown, where the prevalence of diabetes is very high compared to Europe, for instance, or even South America. All over the world, we calculate approximately 400 million people with diabetes. 400 million, and this figure is going to be, according to some sort of provisional data, to be nearly 500 million in 2035. But in a previous evaluation of data published in 2000, so 14 years ago, the figure for 2013, where we are today, 2014, were 250 million. So the provision from 2000 to 2015 of 280 million is now 382 million. So really, that's clearly there is an effect of the environment, because we cannot think that there is a change in the genetic susceptibility to diabetes, because we are all aware that diabetes is a disease that occurs in clusters, in families. So there must be a genetic predisposition. And indeed, there is a genetic predisposition, but we cannot expect this increase in number of diabetic due to genetic changes. It's definitely due to the environment. This is the trends in age standardized diabetes prevalence by region in males. And as you can see, there is all over the world from 1985 to 2005, a similar increase in males, and the same applied to females, although that in females, sorry, in females, for instance, in Oceania and or in Southeast Asia, there is a slighter increase in females. But more or less, there is no much difference between gender in the increased prevalence. But of course, when you talk about diabetes, you have to talk also about children and adolescents. And I'm going to show you why it's important to make this difference. This is the result from prescription data from a UK general practice database. And as you can see here, the prevalence per 1,000 children under the age of 18 is approximately about 3 per 100 per 1,000 children under the age of 18. It's the most common disease in childhood and adolescence, type 1 diabetes in this case, as compared to type 2 diabetes, that is the disease that has the large majority of cases. If we look at the increasing use of antidiabetic drugs among children and adolescents, and including both insulin and oral antidiabetic drugs that actually are given to adults with type 2 diabetes, you may see an incredible increase of use of drugs for type 2 diabetes in children. This is really worrying, because if you think about type 1 diabetes, you think about a child that injects with insulin, because the beta cells do not produce insulin. Whereas the antidiabetic drugs are usually given to adult patients because their insulin does not work, or the receptor on the cells do not take glucose appropriately. So the increase of use of antidiabetic drugs in children testify the increase of type 2 diabetes among children. This is something that was 20 years ago, did not exist. I did not study type 2 diabetes in children. And there is a reason why now type 2 diabetes develop in children as well. Just to make clear what is type 1 and what is type 2 diabetes. Type 1 diabetes, approximately 15% of all cases, is caused by an autoimmune reaction where the body's defense system attacks the insulin-producing beta cell in the pancreas. The body can no longer produce the insulin that it needs, and without insulin, you cannot survive. So the child or the young boy needs to inject regularly 3 or 4 times a day with insulin. Type 2 diabetes, 85% of cases, it is the most common type of diabetes, usually occurs in adults, but is increasingly seen in children and adolescents. The body is able to produce insulin, but either this is not sufficient or the body is unable to respond to its effect. So this is a major difference between the two, and this explains why the drugs we have today are really divided in drugs for type 1 or type 2 diabetes. But until, as I said, a few years ago, type 2 diabetes did not exist in children. Now, this is a projection of the number of individuals aged less than 20 years with type 1 diabetes, 2010 to 2050 in the US population. In the US population, it is expected to have an increase from nearly 200,000 to 500,000-600,000 children with type 1 diabetes, and clearly the white population, the Caucasian population, are those that are more affected by type 1 diabetes compared to Hispanic or Asian Pacific. And there is a genetic reason here, because Caucasian are more prone to develop type 1 diabetes because the genetic makeup of the Caucasian people tend to have genes associated with the destruction of the beta cells in the pancreas. So there is a reason for type 1 diabetes to genetically more prevalent in even in Europe, among population from the northern part of Europe compared to the southern part of Europe. Talking about numbers, it is always help. As I said, the incidence of type 1 diabetes per year, for instance in UK, is about 25 to 30 new cases per 100,000 under the age of 15. This is the incidence that is different from the prevalence. Prevalence tells you the number of all children cross-sectionally present today in the population, whereas incidence tell you how many new cases are developing. And this is important to understand the trends, because you may have the same prevalence, more or less for 3 or 4 years, but you may have an increase in numbers each year that does not influence the total number briefly, but on a long term will increase the total number. So that's the difference between incidence and prevalence. Now, incidence in the UK is, as I said, 25 to 30, but in Southern Europe, for instance, in Italy, the incidence of type 1 diabetes is 10, 15 per 100,000 under the age of 15. So it's doubling the number here in the UK compared to Italy. But there is one place in the world where there is the record of type 1 diabetes, that is Sardinia. Sardinia's got 50 cases per 100,000 at the age of 15. Why Sardinia? They got the record together with another northern European countries, Finland. Finnish and Sardinians have nothing to do in common as a phenotype, clearly, but have the same genetic makeup that means the body, immune system, the lymphocyte attacking the beta cell and destroying the beta cell in the pancreas producing insulin. So we know that this is genetically determined in Sardinia mainly because it's an inbred population. There was a recent study looking at what about couples in Sardinia. Children come from families where the husband and wife, or the male and the female, are resident 2 kilometers apart. Today, I think it's really impossible, unless you go to very small countryside, to have people that get married and have children living in the same little town. So in Sardinia, there is this unique condition of 1.2 million people, they're really inbred population. So that's the situation for type 1 diabetes. That's definitely genetically determined. This is the population with type 2 diabetes. And as you can see, I'll show you again here. Look at the white, the Caucasian, and look at the Hispanic. But look about type 2 diabetes, still in the age group less than 20. Of course, this is less, 84,000, 100,000 compared to, they said, projection of 500,000. But you see that type 2 diabetes is mainly observed in the Hispanic population, and the white Caucasians represent only one third. So this is very interesting because show that the population of Hispanic population and Asian Pacific population in the US represent those that tend to be overweight or obese. That's the reason, and I will show you in the next few slides. Now, we move to the prevalence of type 2 diabetes in urban and rural areas in Arabic-speaking countries, 2011. These are the figures. You see, Saudi Arabia and Egypt have the largest number of subjects affected by type 2 diabetes. And indeed, there is a reason why in the Arabic-speaking countries type 2 diabetes is so prevalent. The reason is mainly due to the genetic makeup in this population, that because they survive starving for many, many centuries, only those individuals that could be able to survive with very low intake of calories made new children. And then they survive, and only those carry on those genes that could make them living without a reasonable amount of food could be able to live and remain and create new children. Now, if you expose this population to high food intake, your metabolism, your cells, are not used to really work and make action and make the energy out of so much food. And what they do, the cells say, fine, great. I block the lipolysis and I favor liposynthesis because one day I will not have food and therefore I use the food that I store. Now, that means that if they continue to eat, they put on weight, and of course, they die of cardiovascular events. So that's why this population, particularly in Saudi Arabia and also in Asia, in China, where now diabetes is exploding, population that were not used to having high food intake. And this happened in 20 years, 30 years, 40 years. It's such a short period of time that we were not expecting such epidemic. This is the prevalence in South Africa. If you look at the figures, in mainly people around 40, 50, 60, and this is the prevalence, you can find 2 out of 10 people in South Africa that are now affected by type 2 diabetes. 2 out of 10. It's an amazing figure. This is in Asian countries in 2013. Malaysia, Singapore, India, China, Taiwan. Considering that in Caucasian population, the prevalence of, just to say UK, the prevalence of type 2 diabetes in UK is 3.5%, similar to Italy. Maximum you have 4%. But look at what is the prevalence in this country, really 10%, 8%, 10%. And in China, it's nearly 9% of population. You know how many people live in China, so we're talking about millions affected by type 2 diabetes. Why did type 2 diabetes become pandemic? So that is the next question based on this figure. Worldwide prevalence of obesity. Where are the brown and the red color? Middle East, America, with 30 to 35% of population classified as obese. Well, to define a person obese, we have the famous body mass index, the BMI. The BMI is a calculation of height per body weight, and if your BMI is above 30, you are obese. Between 25 and 30, you are overweight. Below 25, you are normal. So again, up to 25, 18 to 25, normal body weight. 25 to 30, you are overweight. 30 to 35, you are obese. 35 above, you are severely obese. Now, here you have this classification, and looking at the obese patients, you see where really obesity stands. This is the obesity prevalence in developing countries. Prevalence obesity in Arabian countries in adult males and females aged between 5 and 100 years, WHO estimates, and you see the figure 22 to 48 in Egypt, up 23 to 36, and 19, 37, 24, and this is in Morocco, 3.5 to 31 percent. That's the situation in Italy, just to give you passing from developing country to Italy, where you have the different region, and more or less the prevalence is similar in all country with around 10%, and similar figures are observed in slightly higher in the UK. Don't forget, Italy is a country where the Mediterranean diet and the historical diet has been part of the tradition and the culture. So, of course, that could explain that the obesity is not so high as expected in other countries. But in general, we're talking about three times less than what we expect in the developing country. This is the percentage of US adults who were obese or diagnosed with diabetes. Look at the changed color of America, of the state of America, from 1994 to 2000 to 28. And this is the percentage of people obese. Look what all the East Coast and the central part of America, and even California and all the western part from yellow became orange. And this is diabetes. You can overimpose obesity and diabetes prevalence over 20, 30 years, 25 years. So that's really solid data, suggesting that the epidemic of obesity have made the obesity the epidemic of diabetes. Now, the obesity prevalence, these are interesting new data. The obesity prevalence remains high although no significant changes occur between 2003 and 2012. Now, whereas type 2 diabetes is still on the increase, obesity actually leveled. There was a nice cartoon on Time magazine a couple of years ago when the patient went to see the doctor and the doctor said, let's see your body weight. I said, oh, well done. Oh, patient, yeah, it's great. Oh, you did not put on weight. And the patient was really obese. So the thing is that there is a tendency to stop the continuous growth of the population, at least in the US. Probably this is due to the pressure by media, by newspaper, by doctors, by educators, health educators, and in particular the fact that obesity and diabetes are the major cause of cardiovascular death and morbidity. So I think finally we can see this was published in JAMA, that is the Journal of American Medical Association. It's a very famous journal in the US, similar to Lancet here, and it's 2014. These are new data showing that although there is an increase in childhood obesity and adult obesity level, so we are on the good track, probably. So obesity is clearly the cause of the epidemic of diabetes, of type 2 diabetes. Now, can we prevent type 2 diabetes? And when in the natural history of type 2 diabetes? Because when you diagnose diabetes, clearly this is the final event of a story that started many years before. So I call it the prevention window. This is a more sophisticated slide for student, medical student, but I try to explain this to you because I think it's pretty easy. Natural history of type 2 diabetes. Now you have 6 different mechanisms involved in the hyperglycemia. So when blood glucose goes above 7 millimolar or 126 milligram deciliter, it's due to insulin resistance. That means that your body is not able to make glucose into the cells because insulin is not really interacting properly with its receptor on the peripheral cells. The glucose output from the liver increases. Liver is a fantastic gland full of sugar. When we are fasting, our brain works without insulin. And therefore, if we are not eating, how does our brain function? With the glucose that the liver put into circulation. So there is an increased hepatic output. The insulin level may be reduced in blue with duration of diabetes. The beta cell function, these famous beta cells that produce insulin in the pancreas, these tiny cells within the big gland of the pancreas that actually produce enzymes for digestion. But insulin is the only hormone with glucagon produced by this tiny islet called islet of Langerhans in the pancreas. So the beta cells tend with years to lose their function. Then we have the postprandial and the fasting glucose. Two different mechanisms here are involved in creating this hyperglycemia. The postprandial is when we have our glucose that goes up, reach up to 10 millimolar, but then does not decline as we expect to return to normal levels within the 2 hours after a meal. Or you have an impaired fasting glucose that during night you are fasting because you don't eat during night, but then you wake up in the morning and your blood glucose is 10. Why is that? Even if you did not eat, because the glucose from the liver is released in a higher amount and remain in the blood, and insulin is not capable to reduce that level. So as you can see here, there are different mechanisms involved in why hyperglycemia occurs. And of course, we have many drugs for type 2 diabetes, and each of these drugs can tackle different mechanisms. So if you have a high postprandial glucose, your doctors will prescribe a drug that will interfere with this high postprandial. Or if you produce too much glucose from the liver, you give a drug that stops the liver to release too much glucose. So the good diabetologist is the one that is able to make clear what's the reason why you are hyperglycemic. And unfortunately, that does not occur very often. The GP, particular GPs, because now the GPs are taking much care of patients with diabetes, tend to give the drug to reduce blood glucose without thinking too much which one is your best drug. And the reason why they don't think too much is that in order to find out which one is the best drug for your hyperglycemia, you need to do blood tests, sophisticated blood tests. Not simply measuring blood glucose. You have to measure insulin level, you have to measure the glucose output from the liver, and these are not simple tests that, if you do in a hospital, cost quite a considerable amount of money. So it's not easy, but if you are able to diagnose your diabetes and clarify why you are diabetic, then you can get the best possible treatment. Now, this is the combined impaired fasting glucose, that is IFG, plus impaired glucose tolerance, conferred the highest risk of diabetes progression. When I said the window, prevention window, if you measure your 2 hours postprandial glucose and your glucose fasting in the morning, you may find that if they are both elevated, you can see IGT plus IFG, the relative risk is 12. It's very high, the relative risk to develop diabetes with the both IGT and IFG present. The thing is, as I mentioned before, pre-diabetes, even pre-diabetes, not overt diabetes, even pre-diabetes increases the risk of cardiovascular events and death. This is the relative risk of death that is linear. This is a famous DECODE study. And as you can see, it's really the 2 hours post-prandial that is where you have an increased risk of death, in particular in this subject, before they become diabetic. And the reason why now the new drugs that are given for type 2 diabetes need to reduce not only blood glucose, but also the risk of developing cardiovascular event. All the new drugs are really defined and tested in clinical trial for reduction of the cardiovascular event. Now, by saying that we have to intervene when there is IFG or IGT, impaired glucose tolerance, so before you develop diabetes, and measuring blood glucose is easy, very cheap. I don't understand why still we do not have at home in the normal population the glucometer, like we have the blood pressure tool. We should have the glucometer at home. The glucometer is a very tiny, some of you probably have seen the glucometer. It's very simple. You finger prick, you take one drop of blood, you put that on the strip, and within 5 seconds you have your blood glucose level. So this is very cheap. It costs £30, £25. And I really are thinking that that could be a way to try to prevent diabetes, because at least if you find that your 2 hours post-meal is high, you may go to the doctor and say, look, I have my blood glucose that is high. I found that my blood glucose is high. Like my blood pressure is high. Maybe you do yourself. And then you tell the GP that you have high blood pressure. Many people now do that because they are aware of the importance of this early prediction of a risk condition. Now, as I said, the three main causes are beta cell dysfunction, insulin resistance on the muscle and the liver, and increased glucose production by the liver. Now, if we're going to prevent type 2 diabetes, clearly we have to act at one of these three levels, deciding which one is the level that affects that particular patient. Now, if we look at the first phase insulin secretion, when we have a meal, and in green you see what happened at breakfast and lunch and dinner in normal population, in green, you see that there is an increase of insulin that peaks 800 picomolar at main meal. But if you look at the insulin response in type 2 diabetes, it's actually reduced. Therefore, type 2 diabetes, in addition to be obese, could have an impaired insulin secretion. And this could explain why blood glucose goes up. In the famous United Kingdom prospective diabetes study, the UKPDS, that has been the larger study ever done in the world, looking at what happened before, 10 years before the onset of diabetes. 10 years. This is when diabetes occurred. And this is looking at the insulin resistance and the beta cell failure. And as you can see here, if you calculate that 10 years before diagnosis of diabetes, the beta cell function was 100%, when you reach the time of diagnosis, the beta cell function is 50%. You already lost 50% of your beta cell function. That means the capacity to release insulin in 10 years. And I say 10 years could be at the age of 40 and you are diagnosed at the age of 50. Or you are 10 years before the age of 15, diagnosed at the age of 60. And what actually regulates the speed and evolution of this line? The body weight. If your body weight is high, you have to produce more insulin. And if you produce more insulin, rather than 10 years, in 5 years, you will develop diabetes because your beta cell, being continuously stimulated, will be in a situation where within a few years are reaching 50% of their beta cell mass. So this is when you're diagnosed, and then after 6 years, usually the beta cell function decline up to 20%. And some patients with type 2 diabetes, they need insulin. Usually patients with type 2 diabetes, they do not need insulin, but they need insulin where they've been really longer exposed to a condition of pre-diabetes where the beta cell really lost its function. As I said, the beta cell mass is already impaired at diagnosis of type 2 diabetes. This is again to show you in red the percentage of beta cell mass. This is IFG, so impaired fasting. This is another form of autoimmune diabetes in adults, LADA. And as you can see, compared to normal glucose tolerance test people, look what the beta cell function is. Now we have fantastic data collected in different populations. The good thing about diabetes is that we know pathophysiology. And when a doctor is aware what the pathophysiology is, you feel really confident that you can give the best potential treatment. And this is terrible that despite all this knowledge on the pathophysiology, we still see an increase in diabetes epidemic.
Now, the oral hypoglycemic agents, this famous drug for diabetes, target the pathophysiological defect in type 2 diabetes. And these are some of the drugs that are used today. We have altogether 10 different drugs to be used in type 2 diabetes. Can you believe 10 different drugs tackling hyperglycemia, working at the level of impaired insulin secretion, by reducing insulin resistance, by reducing glucose absorption, and by reducing the glucose output from the liver. 10 different drugs, breakfast, lunch, dinner, other condition, all together with a combination, you reach nearly 400 different potential therapies for type 2 diabetes. 400 different potential therapies. That means, rather than a doctor, you must be an artist to find out which one is the best combination that works for you. What the GP does, just give you one, then give you two, then give you three, then make a new change, just looking at blood glucose and glycated hemoglobin, nothing else. That's wrong. Of course, you need to find out what's the reason of your hyperglycemia. That is an important take-home message. But of course, as I said, difficult, expensive. What the evidence that type 2 diabetes can be prevented or delayed? Do we have evidence that spending a lot of money we can prevent and delay the onset of type 2 diabetes? The answer is yes. Now, these are the lifestyle intervention for type 2 diabetes prevention. This is a study done in China. These are studies done in Finland, in the US, in India. And this is the number of patients that have been followed up for 6 years, 3.2 years, 2 years, 2.5. You may say, well, 3 years. What is 3 years? Nothing. You can prevent for 3 years diabetes. Then you stop, and I'm going to tell you what's happened when you stop the intervention. Now, this is what type of intervention have been made. Diet, exercise, diet plus exercise, diet and exercise, metformin, one drug here. Diet and exercise, metformin, been around for 30 years for type 2 diabetes, and again, diet and exercise. This is the most famous study, published 12 years ago, in the New England Journal of Medicine, comparing over a period of 5 years, placebo, that means that was not, of course, a drug, it's a control, placebo, metformin, that how does metformin work? Reduce the output of glucose from the liver. That's the mechanism of action of metformin. And lifestyle. Lifestyle, that means really losing weight, exercise at least twice a week for a total of 180 minutes a week. So the results are that the best way to prevent diabetes is by lifestyle. The reduction, risk reduction by lifestyle is the, sorry, I'm going back to next, the reduction by metformin in yellow is 30%, reduction by lifestyle is 58% compared to placebo. So fantastic results. 50% or 30% means one in two could be prevented. These are pharmacological interventions to prevent type 2 diabetes. Following that metformin trial, there have been another eight trials. And follow up, again, 3 years, except glargine, that I tell you something about it, 3 to 4 years. And population with impaired glucose tolerance, fasting glucose, obese, and use different compounds that are drugs, mainly, and in this case, origin, there was the use of insulin to prevent diabetes. You may say, why giving insulin to prevent diabetes? But that does not make sense. If then I develop diabetes, I will take insulin. Why should I take insulin to prevent diabetes? The reason is that if you give a tiny amount of insulin, you control your postprandial blood glucose, and you spare your beta cells. That's the mechanism how it has been thought to be use insulin for prevention. Now, if you look at these results, this top NADDM with acarbose, that is a drug that reduces glucose absorption through the gut, reduction compared to placebo, 25% relative risk reduction using acarbose. And that was a study that was published in top journal, first in Lancet and then in JAMA. But interestingly enough, there was a reduction in hypertension, in the absolute risk of hypertension, in myocardial infarction, and in any cardiovascular event, cardiovascular death or stroke. and peripheral vascular disease. All of this P, that means that the data are significant. So acarbose prevent diabetes and complication. Pioglitazone, another trial, act now, reduced the risk by 72% versus placebo. Conversion to normal glucose tolerance occurred in 48% of patients versus 28% with placebo. Still placebo works. That is actually incredible because, of course, by participating in a trial of this kind, when you saw that, when you think that it may have an effect, having such results is amazing. So weight gain, edema observed in the pioglitazone arm may limit its use. Insulin. As I said, insulin, favor insulin or favor standards, as you can see, glargine insulin is the insulin that has the longer effect, giving one injection at night, you can reduce by 70% the onset of diabetes. So really, really good results also with insulin. But of course, 3 years. 3 years is nothing compared to the natural history of pre-diabetes and the development of the disease. So the question is, do prevention intervention have sustained effect? Now, this is the diabetes prevention study, 3 years post-intervention follow-up, and this is 20 years post-intervention follow-up. This is the control and this is intervention. And you see that the curve actually favored definitely the intervention trial. So the percentage of patients that are still off diabetes is 50% of those that did the trial. So 20 years post-intervention follow-up study. Probably the reason why you can get such a good result is because you change the attitude of people. After 5 years of continuing good life, modification in your habits, eating properly, don't put on weight, then you keep going. The thing is that if you do for a shorter period of time, that probably is not enough. And this has been shown by these very good two studies. Metformin, the first drug used, had sustained effect after drug washout. 2 weeks drug washout at the end of diabetes prevention program trial. Diabetes was more frequently diagnosed in metformin versus placebo, but still decreased diabetes risk by 31%. So definitely you have some cases of diabetes, but you still maintain the potential prevention preventive effect. This is the lifestyle intervention continue to have an effect. Most drugs do not. This is the work by Daquin, the Finnish study, and the DPPT. And as you can see, the risk reduction is still there. You can reduce, but some patients develop the disease. This is the risk reduction. Pharmacological, 31, 60, 21, 81, 20, varies a lot among the different trials, the different drugs used, and the different lifestyle. Will diabetes prevention bend the curve of the epidemic? Now, as I said at the beginning, obesity and dietary intake keep increasing. This is grain and fats account for nearly all of the increase in daily calorie consumption since 1970. And these are the figure 2007 compared to 1990 and to 1970. And in 40 years, there is a huge increase of daily calorie consumption. And price of food adjusted for inflation has dropped. That is a very interesting information because the price of added sugars has dropped significantly more than the price of health food. Therefore, that could explain why there's been a change in how people eat, and that could increase the obesity epidemic that we have discussed before. And as you can see here, the protein in green, and the fruit, fats, the vegetables, and so on. Then the question has been raised, and there was a nice paper in the BMJ, taxing unhealthy food and drinks to improve health. Have you heard? I'm sure you have heard about this issue. That this is an example of health-related food taxes. Now, this is what has been done in different countries, in the US, in Norway, in Samoa, in Australia. And so these are the tax rate. As you can see in Australia, soft drink, confectionery, biscuit, and bakery products, 10%. If you look at French, Polynesia, Sweden drinks, confectionery, and ice cream, 60 francs or 0.41 euros or 55. 41 pounds or 55.55 euros. And if you look in Finland, soft drinks and confectionery soft drinks have this amount of tax and of per kilogram of material. So there has been finally an attempt to try to discourage the population to eat bad food or junk food. Junk food taxes might reduce energy intake, weight, and insulin levels over time. This is the first study that rather than looking at weight, simply, because you can measure, and that's very good, measure the weight, but look at insulin level. So in 5,000, the cardiac study, in 5,000 young adults, blood has been collected to measure insulin level in order to find a reduction in the insulin level that is a good witness of a better beta cell function that is not under stress, and of course that you don't put on weight so much. And that is the estimated moderate coefficient of the association between price, the probability of consumption, and the amount consumed among consumer. And this study clearly demonstrated that you can reduce insulin level by increasing the taxes on junk food. There is another approach, financial incentives, based approaches for weight loss. So 57 healthy subjects, this is a study published in JAMA, BMI 30-40, now you learn that 30 is overweight, is obese, were randomized to three weight loss plans, monthly weights in, lottery incentive program. Participants played the lottery and received the earnings if they achieve or lost more than the target weight. Or deposit incentive, participants invested their own money, which they lost if they failed to achieve weight goals. You think people that actually have managed to define a financial incentive of that kind. The use of economic incentive produced significant weight loss, more than the control group, during 16 weeks of intervention that was not fully sustained. I don't know what you think about it, but clearly, if you look at this figure, deposit contract, lottery, the deposit contract works pretty well. Group-based incentives are more effective than individual incentives. So this is another interesting experiment. This paper was published in Annals of Internal Medicine, a top journal in the US. Control group, this is the usual control group, always have a control group. This is individual incentive groups, and this is the group incentive group. And as you can see, the change in body weight, this is minus 8-10, as you can see here, reach after 20 weeks this low value. Therefore, the group incentive work better. $500 per month split among participants within groups of five who met or exceeded weight loss goals. This is the group incentive, whereas the individual incentive is $100 per person per month for meeting or exceeding weight loss goals. Peer mentoring and financial incentive for blood glucose control. Now, this study was done still in America. 118 African-American veterans assigned to the following three groups and followed for 6 months. Usual care, peer mentor, patient were assigned. A mentor who formerly had poor glycemic control, so was a diabetic patient. Mentor and diabetic patient with poor control, but now has good control. HbA1 below 7.5%. The mentor was asked to talk with the patient at least once per week. And the mentors were matched by race, sex, and age. Financial incentive, $100 by decreasing the HbA1c, that is the glucose level, retrospectively for 3 months, by 1%. And some of you that know about diabetes, you know the reduction of 1% of glycated hemoglobin is an excellent result. And $200 by decreasing 2%, that is amazing result. I find that this sort of financial incentives could be good, but I haven't seen yet what I think could be the best way to reach this goal, that is reduction of taxes based on your glycated hemoglobin. So, if you have very good metabolic control, you don't need to go to the hospital. So you don't actually need money to take care of your complications, of your retinopathy, nephropathy, or cardiovascular disease. So you save money, and the National Health Service save money. So far, studies of this kind have not been done. These are typically American. Give money, I give you money. Not to save money by doing a proper approach to reduce the risk. So I have a couple of slides of conclusion, so we have a few minutes for discussion. Call for action, I call it. We must identify patients at higher risk, pre-diabetes. This is absolutely crucial. Modest lifestyle changes are most effective. Sustain intervention. Increase opportunities for community programs to support prevention. It's not difficult. Empowerment, patient groups. We do that a lot in the clinic. Delaying or preventing type 2 diabetes is cost effective and will help turn the tide on the diabetes epidemic. Health taxes for improving adherence to healthy lifestyle or reducing calorie intake might be considered. Now, this is how, this is a slight bit complicated, but I think it may work. There is a genetic background. We cannot do much on the genetic background, so forget about it. There is the genetic background where you are born with, and that's it. But then you have 8 years in front of you where your lifestyle determines how that genetic background can transform you from a normal individual to a diabetic patient. So that is really through lifestyle. Lifestyle means exercising, keep control of your body weight. Then you have this area, wide area of obesity, where from normal blood glucose, you can move to pre-diabetes and diabetes. And obesity plays a major role in determining the damage to the beta cell and to increase insulin resistance and make your liver fat and reek of sugar and glucose. And therefore, you need to control the obesity. And what you can do here, the junk food taxes may stop at this level, the epidemic of obesity. And here, if you are already obese, well, BMI taxes or BMI price, blood glucose taxes or blood glucose price, this is, I didn't put anything about the taxes because there'd be no evidence-based medicine trials showing the effect of taxation or reduction of blood glucose. Whereas there is good evidence-based that blood glucose taxes on blood glucose could work, or also blood glucose price. Then you have the lifestyle intervention. If you are really into pre-diabetes and you cannot stop progression towards diabetes because your lifestyle does not work, well, we have a number of drugs that can be used. And then drugs that can work here, now we have enough data, solid data, with some trials showing that you can prevent the progression towards type 2 diabetes. But then you have the problem of low adherence and good adherence. And here is really becoming difficult because there are patients that definitely do not follow the rules of prevention, do not take drugs for prevention because they don't feel that they are diabetic. And they say, why should I take a drug for prevention of diabetes? I'm not diabetic. I will not develop diabetes. I really take care of myself. I exercise sometimes, but then continue to have the bad lifestyle that before brought that patient to be obese. So that is how the whole diabetes epidemic can be tackled. I'm quite optimistic because finally we have seen a reduction in the growth of obesity, at least in developed countries. And I think this is a good sign. And now the way to go is mainly in children. Because if we are developing type 2 diabetes at the age of 20 or 25, rather than 50, as it was before, is a tragedy. That's the only group of diabetic that really is on increasing rate, is really children and adolescents. And I'm very scared about it. Because 1/3 of population here in the UK is overweight. And 10%, 15% is obese. Therefore, we have to keep our generation healthy, and to do so, we need to prevent obesity, in particular in the young age. And this is definitely our goal, and we must all work very hard to reach this result. Thank you very much.